All right, I'm just going to continue on the topic of marriage. So I don't know if I have as much scripture in this sermon, just because it's following on from the last sermon, and just already setting the groundwork for marriage. But I just want to touch on a couple of topics, and before I get into some other things, they're going to seem a bit random in order, because I'm just touching on some random things. But I just wanted to go over again the topic of, you know, marrying a close relative, just because there was a few questions that came up afterwards and I just wanted to address them and just sort of put it in a concise argument. I didn't feel like I really explained it that well. But basically, you know, why is the moral question of whether or not it's sinful or not to marry a close relative important? Well, the reason why I think it's important, the reason why I'm even thinking of it and thinking about the topic at all, is because, you know, the position of a young earth creation is under attack. The position that, you know, the earth is only 6,000 years old, that God made it in six literal days, as we read in Genesis, is under attack. And one of the things they ask is, well, if Adam and Eve were a real story, and Adam and Eve were the first man and woman, where did Cain get his wife? You know, Ken Ham always jokes from Answers in Genesis. He says that's, you know, there's a couple of questions that people always ask him whenever he travels around, and one of them is, where did Cain get his wife? Because we read about Adam and Eve, and then we read about Cain, Abel, and Seth. If you didn't know the answer, in Genesis 5:4, the Bible says here, and the days of Adam after he had begotten Seth were 800 years, and he begat sons and daughters. So Adam and Eve did not only give birth to Cain, Abel, and Seth, they had sons and daughters. So Cain married his sister. But then the question arises, well, if marrying your sister is sinful, how can God allow Cain to marry his sister and allow that, you know, incest at the beginning when it's morally sinful to do for us now? And this is the why I started thinking about this topic, because it is an inconsistent position. It's a valid objection, right? To say, well, if you're going to take the position that marrying your sister or marrying your brother is sinful, then you have a dilemma. Because in the beginning, Adam and Eve gave birth to Cain, Abel, and Seth, and daughters. So then how did the human race continue? So we have to come up with an answer to this question, and that's why I started thinking about it. But that's, if you didn't know, that's who Cain married. You know, when I posted the video on YouTube, somebody made a comment on it. I don't know if you saw, but somebody made a comment and said, a theory might be, and I'd never heard of this before, a theory might be that, you know, with Cain, Seth, and Abel, God created them a wife out of their ribs, just like they did for Adam. And then you wouldn't have the problem of marrying your brother and sister, because, you know, if you map out the family tree, as long as God did that to two of the sons and they had children, then everyone could marry cousins or, you know, a distant niece or nephew or whatever, or a grandniece or a grandnephew, because the Bible only mentions aunt and uncle, niece and nephew. It doesn't mention your great, your grand auntie, that sort of gap. But to me that doesn't make sense, because to me that is, number one, it's an argument from silence, meaning there's a crucial factor in there that holds that argument together that is not mentioned in the Bible, because God did not mention that he did that for Cain, Abel, and Seth. And number two, you know, I can't remember whether it's in Genesis 5. Oh, was it Genesis? Maybe it's Genesis 4. Let me just go up here. Oh, my computer's running a bit slow. Genesis 4. Oh, maybe not. I'm just thinking of the verse where it says, and Cain called his wife Eve because she was the mother of all living. So if God created women for Cain, Abel, and Seth, then how could Eve have been the mother of all living? Because she was going to give birth to everyone in the human race. So there's a couple of reasons why, you know, I don't accept that argument. But yeah, so that means that Cain married his sister. So then how do we understand this? So did God put Cain in a situation where he had no choice but to sin? I don't think so, and that's why I have the position I do. And you know, you might think, somebody brought this up last week, they say, you might think, oh, marrying my sister. I'm like, yeah, that's disgusting. Because most people would have that first thought. But the reason why I think most people have that first thought is because you grew up with your sister, you grew up with your family, and you know them so well, and maybe you don't like them or whatever, and you know them so well that when you think about, you know, marrying your sister, you just think, oh, that's disgusting. Why would I ever do that? But just think about this for a second. Let's say you were estranged from your family, and let's say you had brothers and sisters in the world, but maybe you had been adopted off, and you met her again. You didn't even know she was your sister. And I know there are stories of that happening where people meet, you know, their close cousins, or they meet a brother and a sister, and because they were estranged, they didn't even know that they were related. So it is possible for a brother to be attracted to his sister, but I just think generally people aren't, because they grow up with them and they have that sort of relationship. And you know, there was something in the news a while back about the Duggars, and how Josh Duggar had, you know, inappropriately touched his sisters and blah, 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 and done things like that. And it was just interesting to see the reaction from a lot of Christians, because a lot of Christians would be like, oh, you know, it was, you know, obviously it was perverted, and he shouldn't have done that. But, you know, some people were saying, like, you know, he had a, you know, perverted mind, and it was just reprobate, and like, how can you be attracted to your sister? But then, you know, your sisters are also girls. You know, they're girls, and they have features that girls have that guys can be attracted to. And Josh Duggar is just a guy just like any other guy. Do you know what I mean? And he was in his teenage years. He did it when I think he was 14 and up. So he would have been, you know, raging with hormones. And he did something he shouldn't have done. But I think the lesson we have to learn, I think a couple of lessons that we learn from the case of Josh Duggar is, you know, boys are not exempt from treating their sisters with all purity, like the Bible says. You know, we treat younger women as sisters with all purity. You're not exempt as a brother from treating your sister with all purity just because you're related to her. And even my wife, you know, her mum would often say to her when they were growing up to be careful of their brothers. You know, make sure that you cover up. Make sure that you're not just walking around the house in a bra. You know, make sure, because they are boys as well. And she's known of instances before where brothers have taken advantage of their sisters. So I think it's important for us to note as parents that these things happen. And when we deal with our children, yeah, it's, you know, I don't think we should just let brothers just, you know, hug and just, you know, be appropriate with their sisters just because, you know, it's still a boy and girl relationship, even though they're blood related. So sisters shouldn't compromise, I think, in the issues of dress and touch just because they're your brother. And I think it's something for parents to take note of. But, you know, the reason why and just to go over this again, the reason why I don't think it's sinful is because in the Bible, there really only are two types of commandments from God. There's either the eternal moral law type of commandment, you know, murder, theft, stealing, and these things are always wrong. You know, they're wrong in every scenario. They were wrong before the Mosaic law was given. In the New Covenant, they're still wrong. But then you also have temporary old covenant laws that were imposed on Israel until the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And these would include, you know, the Sabbaths, you know, food laws and things to do with the priesthood. But some people have tried to argue, you know, that Cain and Abel and Seth were able to marry their sisters on the basis of genetics and say, you know, well, because of genetics, God knew that eventually at this point in time, it would be unclean, and then he outlawed it. And the reason why I don't accept that argument is because I don't believe sin is relative to genetics. You know, it's not that, you know, genetics all of a sudden gets to a point and then something is morally sinful, because if it's morally sinful, it should always be sinful. So the reason why I take this position, and I think it's interesting in Leviticus 20, we won't turn there, that, you know, it is labeled as unclean but isn't given a judicial punishment, is because it is unclean because of what we know about genetics. So am I encouraging people to marry their sisters and marrying close relatives? No, because I think the wisdom that we can glean from the Bible is, why did God make it unclean in the Old Covenant? He made it unclean because of genetics. So we can understand the passage there in light of what we know about science, But do we take the position that it is a moral sin? I don't think we can, because if we did, then we would have a conundrum if we take the position of young earth creation that Adam and Eve were a literal couple that started the human race, because somebody somewhere along the line would have had to marry a close relative. And that's the reason why I don't believe it's a moral sin, it's just unclean. So I hope that clears that up. Okay, so let's go on to the topic of when a person should get married, because I didn't cover that, so I added this to my notes. Of, you know, when should a person get married? How old should you be before, you know, God wants you to be married and encourages that? Well, let's look at a couple of passages, because I think in the Bible, 5:18. Because I believe in the Bible, God encourages us to get married when we're young. And I don't think it's a commandment. So I don't think people are sinning if they don't marry young, because God doesn't command you to get, because if he commanded you, that means if you didn't get married young, then it would be a sin. But we can definitely see passages that encourage us to be married young. And I'll go over a couple of advantages of why you would want to get married young. It says here in Proverbs 5:18, it says here, let thy fountain be blessed. Now maybe we'll just read a couple of other verses, because it talks about, you know, Proverbs 5 is talking about adultery and you know, being with your own wife rather than with somebody else's. It says here, drink waters out of thine own cistern. So it's using this analogy, right, of drinking, and obviously it's talking about a relationship with between a husband and wife. Drink waters out of thine own cistern and running waters out of thine own well. Let thy fountain be dispersed abroad and rivers of water in the streets. Let them be only thine own and not strangers with thee. And look at this. Let thy fountain be blessed and rejoice with the wife of thy youth. So the wife of thy youth. So the wife, when you were young, you got married. Look here in Psalms 127. This is a psalm about, I believe this whole psalm is actually about family. We'll just read the whole lot just because it's short. It's except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. So the house, I believe, referring to your family. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh but in vain. It is vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows, for so he giveth his beloved sleep. Lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. And look at this, as arrows are in the hand of a mighty man, so are children of the youth. So obviously God would want us to be a mighty man. He wants us to have, you know, a quiver full of arrows. We see here later on, happy is the man that hath his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but they shall speak with the enemies in the gates. So I believe God, you know, he wants us to have a lot of children. He wants us to have as many children as possible. That's why he wants us to have a quiver full. And it was an interesting point that Kevin brought up, that, you know, everyone's quiver is a different size. So God is not setting a number on how many children he wants you to have, but everyone has a quiver. But I do think God is encouraging us to have as many as that quiver can hold, because he wants us to have a quiver full. But it says, as arrows are in the hand of a mighty man, so are children of the youth. So we can see there that having children young is something that is mentioned in the Bible. Look here in 1 Corinthians 7. Verse 36, a passage about marriage as well. But I just wanted to point this verse out to you in verse 36. And we sort of touched on it last week. It says here, but if any man think that he behaveth himself uncomely towards his virgin, if she pass the flower of her age and need so require, let him do what he will, he sinneth not, let them marry. So see, the requirement there is just that she's past the flower of her age. And we would believe that to be that she's ready for childbearing. Her, you know, she's menstruating, she's got a period, and she's able to bear children. So that's the cutoff there. It's saying if she passed the flower of her age. It doesn't say, you know, if she's finished school, or if she's, you know, graduated, or if she's, you know, if she's already worked and is stabilized financially. Because, you know, the reason why the world wants us to do that is because they don't value being a mother. You know, they think that a value comes from working a job and making money. But see, in my the perspective I think we should have is the only reason why we need to go out and make money is to provide for our family. Because if you think about it, the reason why we're created is to enjoy God, right, and to serve God, but to be fruitful and multiply, like why, when God created us in Genesis. And God loves children. And there are many reasons why God wants us to marry young. One is so that we can have more children, right? Because if you marry young, the more children you can have. But somebody obviously needs to provide for those children, and that's why the husband goes out and works and provides for his family. So I do think that God encourages us to marry young, past the flower of our age. But another reason why it's a good idea to marry young, we'll just go a bit further up in the chapter. But the Bible says here in 1 Corinthians 7, I say therefore to the unmarried and widows, it is good for them if they abide even as I. But verse 9, but if they cannot contain, let them marry. For it is better to marry than to burn. So not only is the world trying to, you know, push out marriage because, you know, they want to put women into the workforce and they want to basically, you know, get our children into government schools and then teach them and indoctrinate them with the world instead of families raising their children and women raising their children and raising, a lot of children. I believe that they've lost that value system and, you know, we should fight that. But also, when you push out marriage, you go many more years being celibate. You know, because obviously you shouldn't be fornicating before you're married, but God has put a natural instinct in us to desire that act between a man and a woman to encourage us to get married. And what happens when people pull it out? This is why so many people are fornicating these days and fornicating outside of wedlock, because they have that desire, but then they don't think they should get married until much later on, and then they end up fornicating. And this is not just for men. This is for women as well. I mean, sometimes we don't think of women as burning with lust, but women also do. They may not burn as much as men do, but they do. And this is the reason why women also fornicate, because it's a natural desire. There's nothing wrong with the desire to be with a man or to be with a woman, but that's why God, you know, wants us to get married, and that's why we get that desire quite young in life and not in, you know, our late 20s, late 30s, because he wants us to marry young. That's what I believe. But, you know, what are some other advantages to marrying young? Well, number one, I just listed a couple here. Number one, you know, it's easier for ladies, you know, because, you know, there's no secret that when a lady is younger, you know, she's more attractive. It's easier for her to find a husband. And whilst I don't think that should be the main thing that a husband is looking for, it's just a natural thing. It's a natural thing that a man is going to be attracted to his wife, and a younger a lady is, generally, the more attractive she is too. So it's easier for her. But sometimes what happens in the world and in life is ladies put it off because they're trying to go through their studies or they're trying to work, and then they don't get married until they're like mid-30s. But now they're wondering who would like to go after them because they're not as attractive as they used to be. And when they were younger, many guys were going for them. So they had a lot of suitors when they were younger, and now that they're older, there are not many suitors, because all the guys that were looking for a wife have gotten with another lady. So that's one reason. It's easier for ladies. Another reason would be, you know, when you're younger, you're less set in your ways. You're less set in your ways doctrinally. You're less set in your ways habitually. And it's easier sometimes to get along with somebody when you're younger and grow together, as opposed to get to an age where you're already set and it's harder to find somebody that fits exactly what you've become. Another thing would be, you know, when you're younger, there are more options, because as people grow older, naturally they're starting to hook up and to yoke up, and there are less options there. Another one would be that I've already mentioned, is that you can have more children. And the last one I've just got here is if you get married younger, you will be younger when your children are older. Because I remember I knew somebody in Perth, and he had children quite late, and he was always thinking about, you know, when my children are teenagers, he's going to be like in his 50s. You know, and he's not going to be able to keep up with them as easily as if he was in his 30s, you know, and especially, you know, young babies they do take a lot of energy. So, you know, it is good if you go through it when you're a lot younger rather than being a lot older. Okay, let's change topic. All right, another thing is, you know, what about the dowry? Because Gershon asked me about this last week and thought I'd cover it, so I added it to this sermon. The dowry. Now, what is a dowry? It's a payment to the father to marry his daughter. And this concept of a dowry actually is biblical. Let's go to Deuteronomy. So it's a payment to the father to marry his daughter. And, you know, it's interesting because, you know, you can apply things like this because if a dowry is meant to be paid to the father to marry his daughter, this tradition that I don't think Australians do, I don't know if Australians do, maybe you guys can tell me, because I think in Chinese culture, the bride's father pays for the wedding. But, you know, I think in American culture and Western culture, I think in Asian culture, the father of the groom pays for the wedding, right? I think that's generally what our culture is. But in Western culture, it's the father of the bride. And I don't actually think that's biblical because it's actually the groom purchasing the bride from the father. So why should the father be giving away already his daughter and then have to pay for the wedding as well? And we don't see that in the Bible because in Matthew 22, when the king prepared a marriage, he prepared it for his son, remember? The king prepared a marriage for his son and then invited everybody. So this tradition that the father of the bride pays for the wedding, I think actually goes contrary to scripture, and it actually makes it not fair for the father of the bride because he's already losing a possession in giving his daughter away. But, you know, I think the concept of a dowry is biblical. We read here in Deuteronomy 22, verse 28. It says here, if a man find a damsel that is a virgin, which is not betrothed, and lay hold on her, and lie with her, and they be found, then the man that lay with her shall give unto the damsel's father 50 shekels of silver. And she shall be his wife, because he hath humbled her, he may not put her away all his days. So we see here that the dowry was a set fee, so you couldn't just like overcharge, you know, to marry your daughter. You couldn't just lay on any amount. It was a set amount. And I think it's interesting here that there is an amount given, because I think what we can glean from that is that there is a value to purity. Because nowadays, people do not value purity. They think, well, what does it matter if I sleep with one person or I sleep with another person? And generally, after you lose your virginity, you because you've already lost your purity, people that have lost their virginity tend to sleep with more people. Because what's the difference? You've already done it once. The second time, the more you do it, the less serious it becomes. And it's the same with a couple that is dating, right? I mean, once you break that purity, and maybe you kiss or you do something that you shouldn't do, generally it's easier to keep on doing it because the first time has already lapsed and it's already you've already lost that value in that purity. So anyways, it says here that if you sleep with a girl that is not betrothed or not married, the law here actually forced you to marry that girl. And I won't go into this all now, but it's just interesting that God has laws in place to limit fornication. You know, he has laws for adultery. He has laws against homosexuality. He has laws for sleeping with a woman that's betrothed. But he also has laws for people that fornicate to stop its spread and say, hey, if you're going to fornicate with this girl, now you have to marry her. Or otherwise, you have to pay a fine. So if a guy kept on doing it, he wouldn't be able to afford it, right? Because who can keep affording 50 shekels of silver every time you sleep with somebody? And eventually, if the father does not deny you, then you'll have to marry her. And then if you do it again, now you're committing adultery. And if you're caught, you'll be put to death. But just compare this to Exodus 22. Show you here. If we compare this to Exodus 22, it says, and if a man entice a maid that is not betrothed and lie with her, he shall surely endow her to be his wife. If her father utterly refuse to give her unto him, he shall pay money according to the dowry of virgins. So how much money was the money according to the dowry of virgins? 50 shekels. But we see here in Exodus 22 that the father had a choice to not give. So it wasn't that if you slept with his daughter, he had to give her to you in marriage. He could choose whether or not to. But it's interesting that even if he said, no, you're not going to marry my daughter, the man that slept with his daughter still had to pay the 50 shekels of silver because he took her purity. That was the price of the purity. So he is not, and we see there that it's still the father's choice whether or not to give his daughter in marriage. He has the authority over his daughter whether or not to permit that marriage to take place. So even if they were to elope and say, oh, now we slept together, now we have to marry. No, because it says if her father utterly refused to give her unto him, he shall pay money. So he's going to be fined and he won't be able to marry his daughter. And he's probably told to pay that because if then the father wanted to marry his daughter off to somebody else, she's not pure anymore. So then probably the person that she does end up marrying would not have to pay that 50 shekels of silver because she was not a virgin anymore. Now question, can the father lawfully demand a dowry? Well, according to the Bible, I think he could. You know, he could say, you know, if you want to marry my daughter, you have to pay up a dowry. But is it compulsory? You know, does a father have to receive a dowry? Well, no, because obviously if the daughter belongs to him, he can decide whether or not he wants to receive a dowry or whether he wants to give her as a gift to the man that wants to marry him. So I think that's entirely up to him. Now, the question did come up last week is, you know, well does that mean then? Because I think if you read these verses about the dowry, then the question then arises is, well, is a daughter property of her father? Now, in our day and age, it's a very controversial topic because, you know, all the women's rights and the feminist movement and the feminist agenda. But I think if we were to be consistent with what the Bible says, you know, that a daughter is property of her father. Because you got to ask the question then, well, if she isn't, why is the father receiving a payment for it? Do you know what I mean? Like if the daughter does not belong to the father, then why does the father receive 50 shekels of silver in order for you to marry his daughter if she doesn't belong to him in some sense? But see, this is the reason why I take this position. And I know it's controversial in our day and age, but you know, I don't think it should be in God's house. I think we just need to think about this and reason, you know, well, if God says that a daughter is property of her father's, let's just understand this and just understand why that's the case. But let me show you this verse in Exodus 21, because it's this verse that really makes me get backed into a corner and think, well, I have to deal with this verse one way or another, otherwise I don't believe the Bible. I don't know if you've ever seen this verse. People bring this up when they try and discredit the Bible. But it says here in Exodus 21, and if a man sell his daughter to be a maid servant, she shall not go out as the men servants do. Now, if you read this verse, I mean, this is, you can't deny the fact that a man is selling his daughter. Right, so just let that sink in for a bit. But it says here, and if a man sell his daughter to be a maidservant, she shall not go out as the men servants do. So what is this verse talking about? Because people will say, "Wow, the Bible condones slavery. The Bible says that, you know, what good price should a daughter fetch and things like that." But that's what a dowry is. You know, if you think about it, I mean, I think the words that I just used just sound bad in today's context, because when we think of selling something, we think of dehumanizing something, not valuing it, you know, that property is not treated well. But I don't think the Bible talks about it in that sense. And if you're wondering what it means to sell your daughter, I mean, a dowry can really be one way that you've sold your daughter, right? Because he's bought his daughter to be his wife. And I think this is what this is actually talking about when it says if a man sell his daughter to be a maidservant, because I think a girl could be betrothed to somebody, right? And the dowry paid, and you know, as long as she's betrothed to that man, she's her servant, right? Just like a wife is, you know, a wife is my servant too. But that's not talking about how you treat them. Now, look, if you read on further, it says, if a man sell his daughter to be a maidservant, she shall not go out as the men servants do. And now look at the context. If she please not her master who hath betrothed her to himself, then shall he let her be redeemed. To sell her unto a strange nation, he shall have no power, seeing he hath dealt deceitfully with her. And if he hath betrothed her unto his son, he shall deal with her after the manner of daughters. And if he take him another wife, her food, her raiment, and her duty of marriage shall he not diminish. Now, is it right for him to take another wife? No, but it's just saying there that if he does, he's dealt treacherously against her, right? And he's saying that he still has an obligation to look after her, to provide for her. And it says here, and if he do not these three unto her, then shall she go out free without money. So I think we have a preconceived idea when we first read verse 7 and we think, oh, you know, this is, we think of the cotton pickers, right, and the slavery and how they were treated. But that's not what's actually going on here. It's just that a dowry has been paid, the transfer of ownership has happened from one man to another. But the Bible's saying here that if he doesn't do these three things, if he doesn't actually marry her himself, either betroth her to his son, or, you know, if he marries another, he has to keep looking after her, then she's not obligated to stay with him. And it says here in verse 8, to sell her unto a strange nation, he shall have no power, seeing he hath dealt deceitfully with her. So what I understand from that is when he purchased this wife and he paid this dowry, the intent was to marry her, right? And to look after her, or to betroth her to his son, or to continue to look after her, but he didn't do that. So, all that to say this, you know, so we have this principle here of a dowry. We have this selling your daughter to be a maidservant. So I think if we want to be consistent, we can just accept the fact, hey, you know, women are property of their husband. A daughter is property of their father. Hey, children are my property. My sons are my property until, you know, my sons are a bit different, because when they grow up, they can leave father and mother and cleave unto their wife. So yes, God does treat women and men differently, and there isn't a problem with that. The problem is not whether or not you own somebody. You know, so this is what people think. It's like, oh, you can't own somebody, it dehumanizes them. No, that's not the issue. The issue is not whether you own somebody. The issue is how you treat them. Because even in the Old Testament, when you were to buy a Hebrew servant, you had to treat them a certain way. You just couldn't treat them any which way you wanted, and you had to provide for them as well. So it's a totally different idea of what we have when we think of owning a person. This is owning a person and caring for them. And sometimes it was an advantage to the person being bought, right? Because they couldn't afford to take care of themselves, their owner would take care of them. And another point is, you know, well then, if my daughter and my wife do not belong to me, why am I responsible for them? And why does God hold me accountable to something that doesn't belong to me? That's a bit unfair, isn't it? Like, my daughter doesn't belong to me, my wife doesn't belong to me, they can do whatever they want, they're not under my authority, and yet God holds me accountable for my family. So there are a couple of reasons why I think this is consistent, and I think if we as Christians understand it, then we can defend the Bible. Because if you stand on the Bible and you say, hey, the Bible's the Word of God, the Bible has hard passages like this, which with a preconceived idea are hard to understand, and if we resist them, just like the whole Cain and Abel thing I was talking about before, if we resist it instead of understanding how it fits with the whole Bible, then these inconsistencies won't be pointed out to us and we can stand on what we claim to believe. Anyways, I thought that was an interesting topic for you. Now, let's go on to the topic of same-sex marriage, because obviously you can't talk about marriage without talking about what's hot in the press right now on same-sex marriage. You know, sometimes when you go out soul winning, people will ask you, because, you know, they know you're a Christian, they'll ask you, like, what's your position on same-sex marriage? And they ask you that as though you're, you know, sometimes I wonder why they're even asking that. Because, I mean, of course my position against same-sex marriage is that it's wrong, that it's a sin. You know, I'm against same-sex marriage because I'm against homosexuality. So it's just funny that so many people out soul winning ask you this question, you know, what's your view on same-sex marriage. And maybe it's just sad because so many Christians have compromised in this area that they're so used to Christians saying, like, oh, you know, well, it's not ideal, you know, whatever, but, you know, we just need to love them and we just need, you know, that's just what they're doing and there's nothing really wrong with it. We just don't want to call it marriage. You know, maybe they're so used to hearing that sort of response that they're shocked when somebody comes to their door and actually believes the Bible and actually believes what the Bible says about homosexuality. And you know, homosexuality, according to the Bible, is a sin. And it's not just in the Old Testament, because somebody might say, oh, you know, in the Old Testament, oh, that's the Old Testament, we don't follow the Old Testament. But it is in the New Testament as well. Let's just go to Romans 1. And just see it here. It says here in verse 24, wherefore God, this is Romans 1. So this is the New Testament. This is the New Covenant. You can't even say, well, it's in the Gospels. It's still in the Old Covenant. This is the letters from Paul. You can't get more New Covenant than Paul, right? So Romans 1:24 says, wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. So remember, we talked about last week that, you know, fornication, you know, the sexual act is unclean. It's just that in marriage, God does not consider it unclean because the marriage bed is undefiled. Who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause, God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. So we see here that God describes it as vile affections. He describes it as unnatural. It's against nature. And it is unnatural. I mean, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to realize that homosexuality is unnatural. I mean, God, you know, they say that God created Adam and Eve. He didn't create Adam and Steve. You know, there's a reason why females and males exist in the world. It's to bring forth children. And that is natural. And you know, it's funny when people will make the argument and say, well, you see homosexual tendencies in animals, but I'm not trying to pattern my life after an animal. You know, monkey, we went to the zoo and a monkey was there and he did a poo and then he ate his own poo and then everyone was laughing because it was so disgusting. I mean, you're going to pattern yourself after an animal. Are you going to eat your own poo? I mean, this is the sort of, like, they're not thinking through their logic. This is why you never use animals as a reason for why you do things. You say animals don't cover their breasts when they breastfeed. Well, that's because they're an animal, right? They don't have any sense of modesty. They don't have any sense of, you know, covering yourself in shame. We don't pattern ourselves after animals. Animals is not a good reason for why you do things, because animals do things that are abominable. Animals do things that are, and that's why they commit homosexuality, because it's not natural, because animals are animals and we're not animals. So it's not natural. So see, likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman. See, the natural use of the woman. Burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error. See, the Bible says it's an error that they're doing. It's wrong, which was meat. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. So according to the Bible, homosexuality is a sin. So when you're asked the question, you know, are you against homosexuality? Are you against same-sex marriage? I mean, that's a secondary issue. That's not even the issue at hand. The issue at hand is homosexuality even right to do? And according to the Bible, it's wrong. And, you know, ultimately, the Bible is the reason why anything is wrong. You know, like if we were to grill down to the heart of the issue, why is anything a sin? It's a sin because the Bible says it's a sin. And that's why the most important question to debate these days is the source of truth, right? Because if the Bible, that's the most important question really when it comes to any topic, any social issue, any issue of morality, is the Bible the Word of God? And that's why I talk to you guys about these issues where people try and point out inconsistencies in the Bible, because I'm showing you that the Bible is defensible if you have the right positions. You can stand on the Bible and you can defend it and believe that it's the Word of God, because that's the most important question. Because if the Bible has errors and it's inconsistent, then it's not the Word of God. And then how are you going to prove that homosexuality is wrong? Because that's the reason why it's wrong, because the Bible says it's wrong and we believe the Bible is the Word of God. So if it is, then if the Bible is the Word of God, then what it preaches is the truth, and man's opinions are irrelevant. Man's opinions don't change what is truth. But I think God gave us a mind. You know, I love it when somebody brought this to my attention one day. I can't remember whether I listened to a sermon, but, you know, because, you know, a lot of people they don't understand things in the Bible, and they just think, oh, well, that's just, you know, that's just God. We don't have to understand it. We just take it by faith, and we don't have to think it through. But remember, the Bible says the first commandment is to love God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and your strength. So we don't only love God with all our heart. We don't just serve Him with all our might. We also worship Him and love Him with our mind. So God expects us to think about these things. He expects us to think about it. He gave us a mind. He made us rational beings to think about these things and reason them through so that we can understand more about God. You don't want to just, you know, take this cop out and just think, well, I don't understand it, but I'm just going to think of it by faith. Because that's the reason why Christians get the reputation of just being blind followers of a faith and not thinking about it. And unfortunately, a lot of people are like that. So, you know, we can reason through it because God gave us a brain to think and serve Him with. And He's a God of justice and rationality. So the reason why in the Bible that, you know, homosexuality is a sin is because it is a form of fornication. Because you cannot marry the same gender, you are always going to be fornicating, because marriage, like we said in the last sermon, is between one man and one woman. It's linked to the biological fact that a man has a male reproductive organ and a woman has the woman reproductive organ. And people nowadays are trying to split, I don't know what they call it, like they're trying to split the gender from your sex, I think. So they'll say, like, you know, yes, your sex is male, but your gender is what society has brought you up as. And they're trying to detach the fact that you're a man because of your sexual reproductive organs. And it's just how you're raised. And now you've got this transgender movement with Caitlyn Jenner and all this weird stuff. But see, look what happens when you get away from the Bible. When you get away from an absolute standard of morality, then anything goes. Because if there is no absolute standard of morality, then what is right and wrong? Because if we don't believe the Bible is the Word of God and we stand on it, what right do we have to tell somebody else that they're wrong? Morality has to come from an absolute standard. It has to come from God. Otherwise, it can't be imposed on anybody else. So it's a form of fornication. And, you know, same-sex, you know, even, you know, we should put in quotation same-sex marriage, because it's not really marriage. It's an oxymoron, because people of the same sex can't marry biologically and even have children. So when we think about the topic of same-sex marriage, especially it's a hot topic in the political realm right now, you know, people are all up in arms about what to call it. You know, like, oh, you know, how can they call this marriage? The issue with same-sex marriage is not the marriage part. The issue with same-sex marriage is the same-sex part. It doesn't matter what you call it. The issue is that the same sex is coming together. Whether you call it marriage or not is not really the issue. So they can try and redefine the word, but it won't change the biological facts. Because the biblical debate, really, if we're talking about what the Bible says about homosexuality, the debate is not really about whether or not they should marry. The debate is whether or not homosexuality and types of fornication should even be allowed to exist in a society. And this is why God prescribes the death penalty for certain things. And I'll preach on this on another time and go into it in more depth. But the death penalty is to cleanse a society from certain sins. And that's why the Bible says repeatedly, when it says they shall surely be put to death, it says, so shalt thou put evil away from among you. That's why there are certain penalties in the Bible that are given the death penalty, because they destroy society, and fornication is one of them. So the question really is, you know, should homosexuality be a capital crime? I mean, according to the Bible, it is. It says that if a man lie with mankind as he lieth with a woman, both of them have committed abomination, they shall surely be put to death, their blood shall be upon them. So the Bible says that because God does not want homosexuality to be in a society. Now, am I saying that we take the law into our own hands? No. So we don't go out and then just kill homosexuals, because it's something the government is meant to do, and God appointed government in the Old Testament to do that. So, you know, it's not just going out and just killing them. It's bringing them before a court, you know, trying them before two or three witnesses, finding them guilty, and then executing them. But it's not only homosexuality, because people will say, well, you know, are you only against homosexuals? No, because in the Bible, it's not only homosexuality that is given the death sentence. It's also adultery, right? It's also fornicating with a woman that is betrothed. It's also, you know, children that don't obey their parents, or children that smite or curse their parents. So the whole idea of God instituting a death penalty is to discourage people from doing these things and to keep a society strong and stable and pure. Because think about it, God is against all fornication. Because God, he didn't just say execute them for sleeping with the same gender. He said execute them if they sleep with an animal. Execute them if they commit adultery. And even with fornication, remember we talked about it, if you fornicate, you're forced to marry. And then if you marry and you keep on fornicating, now you're committing adultery. So God, you can see across the board, is trying to keep a society pure and stable, because it is, family is the building block of society. And if the family degrades, society degrades. And this is why we're in the situation we are in today, where there is rampant fornication. All the stuff that you're seeing out there is because the family is not being defended. So somebody might say, you know, in Kenya, there was a clip I posted on the church Facebook page. They actually have a jail sentence for homosexuals. So you might say, well, why don't we put them in jail? Why don't we put people that commit these certain types of fornications, instead of executing them, why don't we put them in jail? Well, the reason why we don't put people in jail is because jails cost money. Jails are not free. Do you know what I mean? This is why God instituted the death sentence for murderers and rapists, because think about this. You know, I was talking to somebody at work and I was saying, you know, we were talking about the death sentence and whether or not the death sentence should apply. And he said, oh, you know, I never think the death sentence should apply. But I said to him, well, so at least, do you think that they at least should be put in jail? Because, I mean, they should be punished, right? You can't just not punish them. And he said, well, yeah, I guess that would be preferable. So I said to him, well, what if, because he's got a son, I said, well, what if somebody raped and murdered your son? Are you happy to pay for them to still be alive? Because you're the one paying the taxes. You're paying for them to exist in jail, because the jails are not free. Jails need to be paid for somebody. So I don't think it's just if somebody has committed an abominable crime that warrants the death sentence according to God, but yet now you're going to force the offended party to pay for them to live in jail, and to feed them and to clothe them, and with our justice system now to one day get out and then do it again. There's a reason why God has the death sentence. So people might say, you know, why are you against all these people that do all these things? They're not doing anything to you. Yeah, they're not doing anything maybe to me directly, but what they are doing is destroying society, and that does affect us, because we're not an island. You know, we live in a world with other people, and other people do affect what we do, and God puts certain limits on certain sins. That's why some sins in the Bible don't have a judicial punishment. You know, we shouldn't be punishing, like, using drugs. You know, is drugs a sin? Yes, but should it be illegal? No, because God doesn't prescribe a judicial punishment. If somebody wants to destroy themselves with drugs, then, you know, that's not something that God warrants with any sort of punishment, but it's not something we should be doing, because sin always has consequences, but it doesn't necessarily have to be illegal. And the other thing as well is, you know, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to realize that if two people cannot have children, they're not reproducing, right? They're not getting more people in their camp by having children. They're getting more people in their camp because they're recruiting. And this is why God wants to stamp out, you know, certain sins from a society, because they do infect other people. Because when you're fornicating with other people. So yeah, you have to recruit somebody. And generally, you know, this is just a generalization, but think about it. Generally when I speak to men that fornicate, they want to go after the virgins, don't they? They're not so interested in a woman that's already fornicated so many times. There seems to be some sort of, you know, ungodly trophy associated with being able to sleep with a virgin and make her lose her virginity. So this is why fornication and these things should not be in society, because they do. They come after the precious life, as the Bible talks about. And this is what homosexuals do. This is what fornicators do. And this is what adulterers do. They destroy families and they destroy society, which is the bedrock of a stable civilization. I just wanted to make a couple of points about the problems with the current mainstream pro-family movement. Because when you see in the media, you know, you see the argument go on between people that are for same-sex marriage and people that are not for same-sex marriage. And I just want to point out a couple of problems to you with how they argue and why I think their argument is really weak. You know, number one is they're fighting over definitions and not the sin itself. You know, because when they talk about it in the political sphere, nobody is bold enough to just say, hey, it's wrong. It's wrong to do, and that's why we're against same-sex marriage, because we're against homosexuality. No, they want to accept the homosexuality, but for some reason they just have a problem with it being called marriage. But then they have no problem with it at all. It can exist in society, you know, they can recognize it as a civil union. So they're just fighting over the definition and not over the sin itself. Because in Australia, They've been very creative with marketing, the people for same-sex marriage, because they've hijacked the terms equality. They're trying to hijack the term marriage and what it is, you know, trying to redefine it between, you know, just to any people that are committed to each other. You know, they're hijacking, you know, like the rainbow. They're hijacking even the word love, because love in the Bible is keeping God's commandments. You know, and this is love, that we keep His commandments. So they've been very creative in marketing and they've hijacked all these terms. But, you know, really, if you think about it, in Australia, we already have marriage equality because everybody can get married. They don't discriminate on race or gender. You know, it doesn't matter what country you're from. It doesn't matter what gender you are. You can marry somebody of the opposite gender. What they're trying to do is redefine what marriage is. And the reason why the pro-family movement is weak is, you know, they've already accepted homosexuality, which is the problem with same-sex marriage. They have already decided that it's a valid and moral alternative lifestyle, haven't they? They've already, you know, because if you say to them, is homosexuality wrong? They're like, well, you know, it's a different choice. It's not a choice I would make, but, you know, it's a valid alternative lifestyle. Or they accept the argument that they're born that way. You know, it's interesting that I was reading an article last night about, you know, there is no homosexual gene. Because if there was a homosexual gene, because generally the people that believe that there's a homosexual gene believe also in evolution. So how can you have a homosexual gene and also believe in evolution when being homosexual gives you no reproductive advantage? And in fact, the fact that you are a homosexual, there'll be less reproduction amongst people that are homosexuals. And eventually, after a few generations, that gene should have already died out, because they can't reproduce. So they cannot be born that way, because if they were, natural selection would have already wiped it out, because they didn't reproduce. But not only that, it can't be genetic, because there are identical twins with the exact same DNA. I don't know, you can look at this up on Google, that where one has become a homosexual and one didn't. So if it was genetic, both of them should be homosexual, right? So they're not born that way. This is a lie from the world. This is a lie from Satan. This is a lie from the media to get you to accept that homosexuality is something that is normal. But it's not. It's not genetic. They're not born that way. And there are many reasons why that's a silly point. And, you know, another thing that the pro-family movement have accepted, they've accepted the fact that they've basically lumped it together with race and gender. So I don't think, you know how nowadays when they say, well, you can't discriminate on the basis of race, you can't discriminate on the basis of gender, you can't discriminate on the basis of religion, and you can't discriminate based on on your sexual orientation. And we've accepted that. We've accepted that this lump, these categories should be lumped together. But think about it. The reason why you don't discriminate on the basis of race and gender is because that person didn't have a choice, right? They didn't have a choice what gender they were. They didn't have a choice what race they were. But do people have a choice of what religion they are? Yes, so we should be able to discriminate based on religion, because not every religion is valid. And if a person has a business and wants to discriminate based on religion, they should be allowed to, because it is their choice, right? And if they don't want to hire somebody from a certain religion, you know, that's their choice to do. Government shouldn't be forcing people to tell them who they should and shouldn't hire. And in fact, I think the government should even be telling people whether or not they should discriminate based on gender. Because sometimes you do need to, you know, sometimes you don't want to hire a woman to do a man's job, right? Like building, because a man obviously is going to bring, you know, be more effective and all that sort of stuff. I won't go into that. I won't chase that rabbit trail. So, you know, we've likened it to race and gender, and where religion and sexual orientation are a choice. They're not something that you're born with. And another reason why the pro-family movement has become weak is because they've already accepted that union between same genders to be something legitimate, right? Because we recognize it as a civil union, don't we? We recognize two people that aren't married, who are a man and a woman, as de facto, and then a man and a man, or a woman and a woman, we recognize that in law as a civil union. So then you've got to ask yourself the question, with the same-sex movement and people who argue against same-sex marriage, is it now just about definition? I mean, are they literally just arguing over the word marriage and whether or not to call it a marriage? Because they already accept everything that they do. You know, and they'll even make that point. They'll even say, like in the debates where you listen to them, they'll say, well, they already get all the benefits that a married person do. The civil union gives you all the rights. The civil union's recognized as basically a marriage-like relationship. We just don't want to call it marriage because of tradition and reasons like that. So a couple of arguments that they make against redefining the word marriage is, they'll say, number one, what about the implications to religious freedom? Because one argument will be, well, what about in this country where same-sex marriage was redefined and now you see all this religious persecution? Well, I honestly think I can see how in certain countries that has happened, but I don't think that these issues are linked. Meaning, whether or not we redefine the word marriage is a separate issue to whether or not the government then uses that as a basis to limit religious freedom. So my point here is that just redefining the word doesn't change anything to do with religious freedom, because look, they already have a civil union. They are already treated as a legitimate relationship. I mean, whether you call it marriage or not, what? It's just going to change whether or not they can get some government benefits or something like that. But then we should really be asking the question, should government even be in the marriage business? You know, should government even be regulating marriage? Then you wouldn't even have this issue of, oh, government treating certain relationships unfair over others, because I don't even believe the government should be in that. You know, and people always respond the wrong way to government. You know, they always think that the solution to a government problem is more government. It's not. The solution is to get government out of it. So we shouldn't be arguing from a point of view of government, yeah, they should be regulating marriage and they just shouldn't allow this in government. We should be arguing from the point, well, government shouldn't even be in marriage. It's like Gershon and I were talking about, you know, they want to bring in a tax. I don't know if you guys know about this. They want to bring in a tax for when you buy things from overseas. Because, you know, when you buy something on eBay from America or something, you're not paying the goods and services tax. So they say, well, it's unfair for Australian businesses because they have to charge the goods and services tax. So if you're going to buy something for $100, $110 here, and you can buy it from $100 overseas, it's not fair. So people think the solution then is then tax, you know, the goods that are coming in, instead of saying, well, why are you then taxing the goods here? Why don't you not tax the goods here? And then that will give them the upper hand and people will buy locally because they don't have to pay shipping costs. But it's just this mentality that people think the solution is more government. More government is not the solution. Less government is generally the solution when it comes to financial markets. So, you know, they're trying to argue that, you know, government redefining marriage is going to all of a sudden create all this limitation on religious freedom, but it's not, because it's a separate issue. Whether or not they redefine the word, and then whether or not they come in here and try and force me, you know, to perform marriages or force you to have homosexuals and adulterers in your church, that is a different issue. Because you can change the definition of marriage and not change really anything, because nothing's changing, because they're already accepted, they already have all the same rights, but still be against, you know, forcing people to accept that as a marriage religiously. They are separate issues, even though generally they come hand in hand. Because you know, can the government redefine marriage without my religious liberties being hindered? Yeah, they possibly can. I think it's separate. But, you know, will one day the majority try to vote away my religious freedoms if I stand against same-sex marriage? Well, probably. And that's why it is a downward spiral. It is, they do this, and then this happens, and then Christians are getting persecuted for standing against what they don't believe. But I do think it's a separate issue. My point being that if they redefine the word in Australia, it's not changing anything. That's not saying I'm for same-sex marriage, because obviously I'm against it, but I'm against it for a different reason that they're against it. And that's why I'm just pointing out to you a couple of the reasons why I think the movement is weak. Another reason why that the movement is weak, you know, one of the arguments they'll make is they'll say, oh, we can't redefine the word marriage because we need to protect children, because children have the right to be raised by a mother and a father. But we can redefine the word and just still not give them access to children, right? But the pro-family movement on whole, as I can tell, they're against redefining the word marriage because they want to protect children, but they're not against letting homosexuals adopt children. Do you know what I mean? Like, why, if they're so for children and they're so protecting children, why in Australia are gay and lesbian couples allowed to adopt children? Doesn't that sort of go contrary to their argument? They don't want you to marry because they want children to be raised by a mother and father. But here, gay couple, here's a child for you to raise. You know, what about assisted reproductive technologies? Because that's legal in Australia. You know, where, and if you don't know what assisted reproductive technologies are, there's basically three. One is artificial insemination, which is basically injecting, you know, a man's seed into a woman and then her own seed. And it's basically like a surrogacy. Then you have in vitro fertilization. So in vitro fertilization is really wicked when you know what it is. And a lot of people go and use it not really knowing about it. But in vitro fertilization is basically they give a woman a hormone to make her produce more than one egg. And then they harvest those eggs from her ovaries, right? So they have all these eggs. And then they take the seed from a man and then they fertilize those eggs in a petri dish. So these eggs are getting fertilized. They are creating life in a Frankenstein kind of way and creating babies, because we believe life begins at a conception. But it's only the babies that are strong enough to even survive get injected back into the woman to be fertilized in her womb. And then they throw the rest into the garbage, I guess. You know, these babies that they have created. So they are murdering a bunch of babies in order to get one baby. Because some of those babies don't even survive in the womb in the end because of how it's being done. And this is why you hear about these couples. You know, you hear about couples and they're like seven children, eight children. And you're just like, whoa, like, how is that even possible? It's not possible. It's possible because they're doing IVF and they're killing all these babies and they're just trying to give them the highest chance of having a baby. And then they have like 7, 8, 12 children because that's not normal. That's not natural. So that's what in vitro fertilization is. And full and gestational surrogacy is when you use IVF. You use in vitro fertilization, but then it's implanted into a woman that's not going to take the child. So that's probably what like a gay man and man couple would do. They would use the surrogacy because then they would do the IVF and then put it in another woman and then take that child from them, basically, or purchase them. Now, what is my position on assisted reproductive technology? Well, I'm against all of them because all of them are morally wrong. You know, artificial insemination is basically, you know, you're perverting that relationship and then you're giving that child to parents that are not their parents. Because when you artificially inseminate, the lady that you're artificially inseminating into is the mother of that child. And then you give that child to somebody else who is not the biological mother and child. And then, you know, where are the rights of the child? Where are the rights of the child to be raised by their biological mother and father? Who are you to decide who the mother of that child should be when they have a biological mother and father? So artificial insemination is wrong. I mean, in vitro fertilization, I already talked to you about that. That's wrong as well. And then full and gestational surrogacy is wrong because you're taking it again. You're basically commoditizing children. Do you know what I mean? When you're for these assisted reproductive technologies, basically what you're doing is you are turning children into a product that can be bought and sold like animals. You just breed them and then just sell them off to whoever wants to buy them. That's not what God intended, because God designed the family unit because that child is meant to be raised by their mother and father, and he wants that. And all these artificial ways of producing children are basically destroying that foundational block that God has designed and that we should all be striving for. You know, Penny Wong, I don't know if you've heard of Penny Wong. Penny Wong is a lesbian member of parliament in South Australia, and she recently participated in a debate against this guy called Bernardi or something like that on same-sex marriage. And you know, I don't think, even though I agree with all the points that Bernardi made, because of all the reasons I'm listening to you here, he has a weak argument, right? Because they're arguing over the definition of marriage, and he's making all these points, and he made the point about children. Well, somebody else made the point to Penny Wong about children, and basically she wrote an article or made a statement saying, you know, memo to this person, I think it was Eric, says memo to Eric, we've already got children. And this is the point I'm trying to make. If they're trying to say, hey, we don't want you to redefine marriage because we want to protect children, here's Penny Wong, a lesbian member of parliament, she's already got two daughters. But how does she get those two daughters? With IVF, right? She had IVF and implanted it into her partner. Her partner gave birth to these two daughters. And, you know, what they really should be saying and taking a stand is, you know, you have two daughters, but you're not the real mother. You know, you're not the father. Those two girls have fathers that Penny Wong has denied them of, because in the name of human rights, and she's so obsessed with her own right to have children, she's not even thinking about, you know, stripping these girls away from their biological father, not even giving them a choice whether or not they want to have a biological father and mother, and then just raising them in this perverted relationship. And this woman, Penny Wong, she's at the forefront of the same-sex marriage debate, you know, because she's a member of parliament, she's respected, and she has children already. She's like their poster child for redefining same-sex marriage. But you might say, well, what about adoption? Because adoption, you're giving a child to somebody who's not their mother or their father. Yeah, but see, adoption is an exception. You know, adoption is when, you know, maybe the parents die or whatever, and now you have a child without their biological mother and father, but the whole idea of adoption is to put them in the situation that is similar to what is natural, not creating them to adopt them. I mean, that would be wicked, right? I mean, if you're creating children just to adopt them, that's what these assisted reproductive technologies do. You're creating children in this Frankenstein method just to deny them from their mother and children. Because nobody would say that adoption is ideal. I mean, it's a scenario that you couldn't help, and then now you're helping this child that is not in this ideal scenario, whereas nowadays they're creating this scenario. So, you know, one, they're just arguing about the definition. Number two, they're saying it's about the children when they're not consistent, because they allow all these things to happen where children are given to people that aren't their parents anyway, and they're not fighting that. And number three, the movement says it's about family stability. And they say, well, we can't redefine marriage because, then we're sort of like not promoting family stability and blah, blah, blah. Well, if that's the case, why are they not against adultery? Why are they not against fornication? You know, why are they not against no-fault divorce? So in the conversation about redefining same-sex marriage, or marriage to include same-sex couples, they're not bringing these points up. You know, I've never heard somebody say, you know, well, yeah, it should be illegal to get divorced. It should be illegal to commit adultery as well, but they just don't want same-sex couples to do it. So they're not fighting to stop these things. You know, they're not fighting. They're not saying that it's wrong for a wife to take out a restraining order against her husband, because any wife can just do that. That destroys the family, right? Because now it's illegal for them to even try and reconcile. You know, they're not fighting for children to not be even taken away from their parents. They say, oh, it's all about the children, and then they have departments where children can just be taken away from their parents. How does that even make sense? So my point is this, is that, you know, the pro-family movement they have weak arguments because they're not debating the heart of the issue. The heart of the issue is that homosexuality is a sin. You know, they're just going on about redefinitions. Because think about it from their point of view. If you're a same-sex couple and you already are recognized as legitimate, your love is recognized as legitimate, your relationship is recognized legally, then to me, like, it makes sense. Like, it's almost like I support their argument, because if you're already going to recognize it, then and legally they're already treated the same, then why are you discriminating against them? Why are you not recognizing them as marriage when you already technically do? Do you know what I mean? Whereas that's not the issue. The reason why we're not recognizing it is because homosexuality is wrong. And I just want to finish on this point, and you know, this is kind of like a bonus feature, because it doesn't really have anything to do with the sermon. But I find that this issue is the same with the whole issue about Planned Parenthood right now, where people, if you don't know what's happening with Planned Parenthood in America, see, this is why you got to be on Facebook, guys, because you got to keep up with the issues of what's happening. I use Facebook as like my news feed. But you know what's happening with Planned Parenthood in America? Basically, Planned Parenthood is a healthcare provider for women in the United States, and they provide things like sex education, STD testing, cancer screening, but they also provide abortion services. So they services to kill children. So basically, they're a service that supports fornication and murder. That's how I would define them, but they exist in America. And what happened was, an organization, Center for Medical Progress or something like that, they basically went undercover to try and expose Planned Parenthood for selling aborted baby parts. Because what was happening, because they're doing so many abortions, right? And they're using these baby parts for scientific research. So what would then happen is that they would sell these aborted baby parts, and they would say, oh, we're not selling them. It's just reimbursement of costs to transport the goods and blah, blah, blah. But then there are these videos of these people basically haggling for the cost. So if there was a set cost for distribution and transporting, why is there a negotiation on how much there should be? So you can go on YouTube and you can watch these videos. Just be careful, because some of them are quite graphic. So if you don't want to see that, the last video they brought out was disgusting, because it's basically, you know, they're bringing out this aborted baby and they put it on this dish on a light table, and it shows them actually fishing through the parts. And the people that are doing it actually recognize that it's a baby. They're like, oh, look, there's the head, there's the leg. Oh, it's a little baby. One of them even jokes and says, oh, it's another boy. And they're doing this to these babies, and it's just how you just think it's so bad. I mean, you watch it and you're just disgusted at this thing that is going on, and it's hard to even fathom that they are still allowed to exist. So, you know, I herald these people that did this. These guys are heroes. These guys did something really good to go under. They went undercover basically for 3 years. When it had all these conversations basically pretending to be a fetal tissue procurement company. And now they've come out with all these videos, and now they're trying to expose them for what they do and the abomination that is abortion. Because abortion is murder. They are killing innocent children. And you know, the internet went all ablaze recently as well with this lion. You know, Cecil, did you guys hear about Cecil the lion? So Cecil the lion, a dentist, basically paid $50,000 to go hunting in Zimbabwe. And then he hunted down this lion, and he posted a picture saying, you know, like, he killed this lion. But what he didn't realize was that this lion was part of this research project, and it was like a very famous lion called Cecil the lion. And then the internet went ablaze saying, like, oh, this murderer, this person that killed this lion. And to the point where they were sending him death threats. He had to close down his dentist business and all this stuff. And then I was just waiting for the day that the meme would come out where people, you know, they're so upset about killing this lion, but there wasn't even this much outrage over Planned Parenthood killing thousands and thousands of babies every day. How many thousands and thousands of babies are being aborted and killed and murdered, and they're going off about this lion? And you know what's funny? Because one of my friends on Facebook said, you know, lions, they kill endangered species, don't they? They kill zebra, they kill giraffe, they kill all these endangered animals. So you could even think this hunter actually saved a lot of animals, right? Because this lion didn't kill all these animals. Saved at least, you know, tens of animals that would have been killed by this lion. And then you wonder, you know, what if this lion was pregnant? What if the lion was pregnant and they did an abortion on the lion? Would they have a conundrum now? Because they have no problem with abortion. That lion, the baby fetus lion is not alive, right? According to them. So you can abort all the lions you want. But no, they don't, because, you know, it's like you see these memes going on Facebook where, you know, there's like a $100,000 fine by destroying a bald eagle egg, which is not born yet. But then you can kill all these babies and that's not illegal. It's disgusting. So, you know, that's what's been happening on the internet lately. You know, all this ablaze about lying, but then Planned Parenthood was exposed for doing all these things, which is good because I'm against Planned Parenthood. I'm not supportive of Planned Parenthood at all. But the point I just wanted to make here is, it's just like with the same-sex marriage issue. The issue is not, with the whole Planned Parenthood story, the main issue is not what you do with aborted fetal parts, right? Because that's who they've tried to attack. They've tried to attack Planned Parenthood as though they're the cause of all these things. But they're not, are they? Because think about it. Is Planned Parenthood, are they the problem? Or are they a symptom of the problem? So we're attacking the symptom, aren't we? We're attacking Planned Parenthood and trying to put all the blame on Planned Parenthood for doing all these things. But think about it. Planned Parenthood is a provider of services. They don't go out and abort babies on unwilling mothers. There are mothers coming through their doors to get their children aborted. And nothing that I've read and heard about Planned Parenthood is saying anything about the mothers that are sending their children for the slaughter. I read statistics that, you know, Planned Parenthood, I think they abort, they carry out about 300,000 abortions a year. 300,000 abortions. That means that 300,000 mothers walked through their doors to kill their children. So you've got to ask yourself the question, who has the greater sin? If you remember when Jesus stood before Pilate, when he said, "Thou should have no power against me, except it were given thee from above. Therefore, he that delivered me unto thee hath the greater sin." So I'm not for Planned Parenthood. You know, obviously Planned Parenthood is a wicked organization. They're basically facilitating murder. But I think as Christians, we need to put it in perspective that the real culprit, the real people we should be angry at are the mothers that are going in and killing their children. And that's what has to stop. Because if you close down Planned Parenthood, they'll just go somewhere else for the abortion. Or they'll just kill that, you know, this is why you have to understand. Like, it makes sense to me. If you accept same-sex couples as a legitimate couple, then it's hard to argue why you shouldn't call it marriage. And it's the same with the abortion issue. If you accept abortion, if society accepts that it's legitimate, then what you do with the aborted fetal parts is really a secondary issue. Because it makes sense to me, right? Like, if they're gonna argue from the point of view where abortion is fine, well then what is wrong with donating the aborted fetal tissue for research? What are you gonna do then? You're gonna throw it in the bin? Isn't that even more of a waste? That's the argument they have. The babies are being aborted anyway, so why waste the tissue? Why not donate it to research? Because to be honest, you know, that's really the question. What's wrong with selling it off and, you know, getting sending it off to a research lab to do research with it? But that's not the issue. The issue is the fact that the babies are getting aborted. So I'm not saying that I support what Planned Parenthood does. Of course, what they're doing is wrong. You know, an assassin, for an example, has a horrendous job. You know, it's wrong, it's sinful. But my point there is, should we be more angry at the assassin? Or should we be more angry at the person who's hired the assassin? And I think we should be more angry at the person that has hired the assassin, because without the people hiring the assassin is out of the job. If people were not aborting their children, Planned Parenthood wouldn't exist. And then if you don't even have enough fetal tissue to donate, then it's a knock-on effect. Do you see what I mean? So I just wanted to bring that to your attention, because, you know, that is an issue that is sort of, you know, quite large on the internet right now. And I just want to bring people's perspective back, that there are mothers killing their children, and that really are the people that have the greater sin. But it's not being talked about at all. Because, yeah, it's easy to condemn an organization, But if you start condemning the mothers, maybe now you're condemning your actual constituents, right? The actual people that are going to be voting for you. Alrighty, that's it. Does anyone, any of you guys have any questions so far about anything I said? Sorry, I got off a couple of rabbit trails, but I just think it's disgusting what they're doing with children. And you know, like I just remember watching the first video and just, yeah, it's like, it's a danger to be desensitized to it. And maybe, you know, I'm compassionate on the actual people, you know, the way they talk, because obviously if that's your business, you know, they've been desensitized to the fact that that's a baby all mashed up on that dish there. You know, but you think about it, when you look at these children and you just think, you know, can you imagine doing that to one of them? But that's what they've done. They've pulled it apart. But watch the videos if you get time, because the third video they brought out was basically a lady that was hired to fish through the parts. And the first time she had to do it, she fainted, you know, and then they had to wake her up, and then she said, you know, the nurse was joking with her and saying, oh, don't worry, that's not the first time it's happens to everybody. Anyways, sorry to end on that topic to go into lunch, but let's pray for our nation that this wouldn't happen here, and let's start getting ready for lunch. We thank you Lord for your word. Thank you that you help us to understand a lot of these issues, and we just pray, Lord, that you would stop this abomination. Well, not that you would stop that, Lord, that you would help us, you would help Christians to stand up and take a stand against what is happening in this world, that it's an abomination. And Lord, help us not to be desensitized to it. May we fight and speak up for those that are being killed. Help us reach the mothers, Lord, and not just fight on secondary issues. Thank you, Lord, for our church. Pray that you bless the gathering, and thank you for those that have come this morning to learn. And I pray sermon was a blessing to them. And we love you, Lord. We love you, and love you for what you did for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay.